Hello, my name is Konstantinos Karanasos, and today I will be presenting Mercury, which is a system we built at Microsoft to enable hybrid, centralized, and distributed scheduling in large shared clusters. So this is a joint work with all these people you see here. And so the first four of us are members of the Cloud and Information Services Lab, which is an applied research group within Microsoft. And the rest of the people are part of the Big Data product group, with which we collaborate closely. And let's first see what is the current picture in clusters today. So as it was also highlighted by the Bistro talk earlier today, cluster operators want to maximize cluster return on investment. And in order to do so, we see the trend that more and more we do consolidation of workloads. So we use the same cluster in order to submit various different types of workloads. We have shared clusters thus. And by doing that, we have in turn a wide variety of workloads being submitted at the cluster. And so, for example, we can have at the same time long-running services running in the cluster next to production jobs with strict SLAs, next to ad hoc best effort exploratory jobs. And just to become a bit more concrete, here I'm showing you what is happening in Cosmos today, which, by the way, Cosmos is one of the central cluster frameworks in Microsoft. So here I'm plotting the CDF of the task runtime and the job runtime of the jobs that get submitted in Cosmos. So with the blue solid line, you can see the task runtime. The other line is the job runtime. And two main observations here. The first one is that we have a great variation in the task runtime. So we have tasks varying from sub-second to tenths of thousands of seconds. And the second observation is that more than 50% of these tasks are small, so they are smaller than they're shorter than 10 seconds. So we have a lot of short tasks. And the problem we care about here is how do we do resource management in these clusters? So we have resource management frameworks that provide APIs in order to acquire resources and from the cluster and then run jobs. So probably you are familiar with some of the systems, Apache Yarn from Microsoft, Apollo, Mesos, Omega, and Borg from Google. So for sure, it's not easy to achieve high cluster utilization in this setting, in this shared cluster setting. And so far, there have been proposed either centralized or distributed solutions for the resource management. And here, first, before diving into the details of Mercury, I want to give you some details about the general architecture of a centralized resource manager and then of a distributed one. So for a centralized, I'm using the example of Yarn, but this pretty much is the same, more or less, for the other centralized schedulers, such as Mesos, Omega, and Borg. So we have the nodes of the cluster, and then we have a single logical entity, which is the resource manager, that is responsible for all the scheduling decisions in the cluster. So then we have one application master. So we have one application master. You can see the application master as a job orchestrator. So we have one app master for every job, let's say for every MapReduce job or for every DAG that gets submitted in the cluster. And then the application master negotiates with the resource manager. So it asks for some requests some resources. Then the resource manager that has the global view of the cluster replies and says, oh, you can use these many resources. So we have the allocation. And then once the app master has been granted resources, it can then go ahead and start the task in the cluster. And as you can see, the RM, that is the single RM here, the single resource manager, resolves all conflicts and guarantees resources to applications. Now, at the other extreme, we have the distributed resource managers, such as Apollo and Sparrow. So here we have, again, the node managers. We have queues in each node manager. And then we have application masters again, so one per job, that submit. That now, the big difference is that we don't have a central coordinator, but instead, each application master can act as a scheduler and submit directly tasks to the nodes. So you can see that's the reason also we need the queues, right? And so we have application masters submitting directly to the queues. And also in most of the systems, we have a loose coordination through a resource monitor. So for example, every X seconds, every 10 seconds, you can have the node managers reporting their resources so that the application masters can know where to queue their tasks. So summing up the centralized versus distributed scheduling, so on one hand, we have the centralized schedulers, which having the global view of the cluster are really good for heterogeneous workloads. Also, they can do much better task placement, and they're better also for enforcing scheduling invariants, such as, for example, fairness or capacity. And on the other hand, we have the distributed schedulers that provide better allocation latency. They can lead to better slot utilization and also are better in terms of scalability. So in our system, Mercury, here's the key insight. So we make the observation that clearly centralized and distributed schedulers are complementary. So we are after a hybrid approach, and the very idea of the system is to trade performance guarantees that the central scheduler can give you for allocation latency that the distributed schedulers can give you. So the applications can now choose among different scheduling types, and this can be done based on the job type, let's say if you have an SLA job, on the job characteristics, if you are a mapper, a reducer, et cetera, the cluster load, et cetera. And so what is important is that Mercury provides a programmatic way to use resources that would remain otherwise idle. And we have implemented our system and compared it with Yarn, and we achieve up to 40% better cluster task throughput and up to 66% better average job latency. So now let's see some more details about the design and implementation of Mercury. So this is the conceptual, say, Mercury architecture. So we have, again, the Mercury runtime, which are the nodes of the system. And then we have a Mercury resource management framework that now consists of two types of schedulers. So we have a single central scheduler that is good in terms of guarantees but does slower allocations. And then we have a set of distributed schedulers, you see on the left-hand side. And these are more than one, and they provide faster and lower latency allocations. And so again, now we have the application master that when it requests, so it petitions the Mercury runtime for requests now for resources, and it also specifies the resource type. I'm going to tell you shortly what this is. And based on the resource type, we can decide whether we're going to go to the centralized scheduler for the allocation or to the distributed scheduler. So as I said here, the application master determines the resource type. So in our system, we have defined so far two types of containers. So we have guaranteed containers and queueable containers with different characteristics. So the guaranteed containers are guaranteed to start and are also guaranteed to run to completion, so nobody can preempt them or kill them. And on the other hand, the queueable containers are executed opportunistically. They can be queued in the end hosts. They're not guaranteed to start, neither are they guaranteed to run to completion. So they can, for example, be preempted or killed in case of resource contention. And due to their characteristics, we have opted for allocating the guaranteed containers through the central scheduler and the queueable containers through the faster distributed schedulers. And again, to give you some examples about how these container types would be useful in practice. So let's say, for example, the first example is based on the priorities of the job. So you could think that we can use guaranteed containers for critical SLA jobs, where we want to guarantee their performance. And we can use queueable containers for background jobs of smaller priority, of lower priority. Another example could be based on the runtime, so on the task runtime. So queueable containers are more suitable for map tasks that are typically faster, so they can be executed fast without being preempted, with lower probability of being preempted. And guaranteed containers can be used for reduced tasks that are typically longer. And another kind of crazier idea would be in terms of DAG optimization. So if you have a DAG, you can use guaranteed containers in the initial stages of the DAG, and at the same time, you can use queueable containers to sample some downstream operators and do on-the-fly optimizations. So we have implemented Mercury on top of Yarn, and by extending Yarn. So here I'm going to talk about the specific changes we did to Yarn in order to enable our hybrid scheduling. The basic difference is first, in each node manager, we have added a local RM, which will be responsible for doing the distributed scheduling. And also, we have added queues at each node manager in order to enable the distributed scheduling. We have kept the centralized resource manager of Yarn, and we have also added the Mercury coordinator, which can be useful for they're doing some loose coordination for the distributed scheduler. We also have some framework policies and application policies for determining the container type per task that I'm going to talk briefly about in the upcoming slides. So now let's see how we do the request and the allocation of different types of containers. So first about the guaranteed containers. We have our system in the cluster. So we have an application master that gets started in one of the nodes. And then the application master now no longer talks directly to the resource manager, but instead it talks to the local RM, and it specifies that it wants, it's asking for a guaranteed container. And then the local RM sees that this is a guaranteed container, so it should be allocated by the central resource manager. It forwards the request to the central resource manager, and then this is like stock yarn. Again, the resource manager replies, gives the resource, and then the application master can start the container to one of the nodes. Now, on the other hand, during the request and allocation of queueable containers, again, we have the application master. And it submits a request for a queueable container this time to the local RM. The local RM sees that it's a queueable container, so it bypasses completely the central RM. It does the allocation locally, and then this this AM can go and queue the request to one of the node managers. And it adds it in the queue, and we send the task there, and we periodically check the queue, and when there are available resources, we execute these queueable containers. Now, of course, there can be conflicts due to the way in the task execution, due to the fact that we have containers of two different types, handed by two different types of schedulers, but over the same resources. So whenever we have a conflict between two guaranteed containers, actually there cannot be a conflict just because the central scheduler will never oversubscribe a node with guaranteed containers. When we have, let's say, a conflict between guaranteed and queueable containers, the guaranteed container always wins as it has the higher priority, and the queueable container will be preempted or killed. And when we have two queueable containers, this is resolved through the queuing mechanism. Now, as we said, Mercury exposes the API for applications to choose the container type. But in order to do so, we need to define some application policies that determine actually what container type will be used for each of the tasks. So as a first implementation, we have defined this policy. We call it hybrid GQ. So what it does is that it gives queueable containers to all tasks that are shorter than X seconds in this percent of the cases. So although this is simple enough, it is actually also quite flexible because with this policy, we are allowed, by tuning the parameters, we are allowed to, let's say, do fully centralized scheduling by doing only guaranteed asking only for guaranteed containers, fully distributed scheduling by asking only queueable, or a mix thereof. So we can have a distributed for a percentage of small tasks. So let's say you can say, I want queueable containers for tasks that are shorter than 10 seconds in 70% of the cases. And along with the application policies, we also have framework policies that are important for the operation of the system. I'm not going to go into much details about those, but I'm just highlighting the important bits. So we have enforcing invariants. So this means that for the guaranteed containers, we can enforce capacity and fairness. And for the queueable containers, we can enforce quota. So let's say you're not allowed to have more than 100 queueable containers per application. We also have placement policies, so we respect locality constraints, and moreover, during the placement of the queueable containers, we want to minimize queuing delays, so we have a mechanism for that. And finally, we have load shaping policies, which are responsible for maximizing the cluster efficiency. And I'm going to talk a bit more about those. So first of all, we can split them in three basic categories. The first one is that we dynamically rebalance load across nodes. So you can think that during the operation of the system, we have imbalance due to stale or imprecise queuing delay estimates. And what we are doing is every few seconds, when there is a delay more than we actually dynamically specify what is the biggest, the longest queue delay that a container can have, and then we requeue tasks when the queuing delay is higher than this. And another thing that we're doing is we're doing queue reordering. So this is done based on the job arrival time. So within its queue, we reorder tasks based on the job arrival time. And we saw that this improves a lot both job tail latency and task throughput. And finally, we have what we call resource policing, which is kind of a way of minimizing the queuing for queueable containers. And we do that by adding limits on the memory that can be used by queueable containers at its node, and we do that dynamically. And now some experimental results. So we have evaluated Mercury on a cluster of 256 nodes. You can see the characteristics of the cluster there. We are using Yarn 2.4, and on that we have also included our Mercury extensions. We are using Tez. If you're not familiar with Tez, it's the next generation MapReduce. From Apache, and we're using GridMix for generating our workloads and submitting the jobs. And finally, we have both synthetic and Microsoft-based workloads. So first of all, let's look at the task throughput with increasing task duration. So what you can see here is, first of all, the only G, the only G strategy is when we have only guaranteed containers, so this is stock yarn, and the only Q is for completely distributed. And then we have jobs with tasks of different durations. So we have 2 seconds, 10 seconds, and 20 seconds. And the each box that you see there, first of all, the green dot is the average. The red line is the mean. And then within the box, we have the 25th and the 75th percentile, and the whiskers are the 5th and the 95th. So depending, so the first observation is that the longer the task runtime, the shorter the task runtime, sorry, the higher the gain that we get by using distributed scheduling with Mercury. So we can get up to 41% task throughput improvements for short tasks, and this is for the 2 second case. But even for the 20 second case, we already get 15% better better task throughput. And now this is for homogeneous tasks, right? For only for 2 seconds, 10 seconds, and 20 seconds. Now we have also created a workload that is based on the Cosmos character, on the workloads we get from the Cosmos clusters. And here we have different application policies. So we have again only G, which is stock yarn, only Q, which is distributed scheduling. We have 50% Q, which is randomly give queueable containers to 50% of the tasks. We have queueable containers only for the tasks that are shorter than 5 seconds, and then shorter than 10 seconds queueable only in 70% of the cases. So depending on the application policy that we use, we can get gains when compared to yarn from 3.5% to 35.3%. So even for a mixed workload, our gains are very good. But now we want to see in the next slide, how can we translate this task throughput win to a job latency win. So again, for the same workload, what I'm plotting here is the CDF for the task completion time, the task latency, the job latency, sorry, for jobs first of 3 seconds, then of 11 seconds, and then of the 170 seconds, or longer. All these are within the same workload, right? So although the 50% randomly queueable containers were giving us the best task throughput, actually, as you can see, they cannot be translated to job latency win as well. However, on the other hand, if we become smarter and we take into account also the task duration, so you can see that in the smaller than 10 second 70% queueable containers, we get much better results because we are comparable to stock yarn for short tasks, as you can see in the first graph. But at the same time, we get significant improvements for longer tasks. So you can see for the 170, we get really much better job latency than both stock yarn and the purely distributed case. To conclude my talk, so first of all, let me give you a bit the bigger picture that we are after. So in our group, so first of all, you can see this is the stack we are envisioning. So on the top of the stack, we have the application engine. So you can have your Spark, Storm, Giraffe, Hive, big queries, or what have you. So these are the application. Then a level below, we have what we call the per job resource management. So this is, for example, you can think of it for each job how it negotiates with the central resource manager for resources. So you can have the Spark runtime, you can have the application master of for MapReduce, Tez, Reef, etc. And then below that, which is actually the biggest focus of our team, is how can we do cluster-wide resource manager? And this is what we call Yarn++, since we are building on top of Yarn. So there we have so far contributed three systems. So the first one is Rayon, which with Rayon, actually, what you can do is you can teach the resource manager about time. So you can specify SLAs, you can specify deadlines, and then the scheduler does the packing so that you can meet these deadlines. And then we have Federation, which is used because it is shown that the Yarn resource manager cannot scale up to 4,000 nodes while we are targeting in Microsoft tens of thousands of nodes. So with Federation, actually, we are targeting this problem of scalability. And finally, we have, on the lowest level, we have Yarn with Mercury that I described today. And also, one other project that has come out of the group is Reef, which is also open sourced, and it's one of the resource management frameworks that can be used. And this is a multi-person, multi-year project, and so we are also hiring, and also we're looking for students. So come talk to us after the talk. And to conclude what I've talked to you about today, we are targeting our focuses on resource management for heterogeneous applications in large shared clusters. I have shown you a way of combining the best of both centralized and distributed schedulers. We provide applications with Mercury with an API to choose the scheduling type based on their needs. We saw up to 40% task throughput win and up to 66% average job latency win. And we are currently contributing our code to Hadoop, to Yarn. And you can also actually follow the open sourcing project in this Jira, so in Apache. And also we gave in Hadoop Summit a couple of months ago a longer version of this talk. And with that, I want to thank you, and I'll be happy to take any questions.
Hometown from Alibaba. So I like this talk. There's a lot of interesting ideas. But one thing I want to argue is that a lot of things you talked about is really not intrinsic to the combination of centric and distributed scheduling. So you said about centralized scheduling has long latencies. But in 2014, we have a VLDB paper that has a incremental scheduling so that you don't do the polling. The application master posts the resource demands to the master, to the resource manager. Then when the resource is available, it just directly notifies the application master, so that our results shows that the allocation latency is only in milliseconds. So it's not a long latency. The other thing is that even if the scheduling latency is long, you could still potentially queuing a lot of tasks on a local node, and reschedule it if your prediction is wrong, so that you can still drive up the utilization.
Mm-hmm. So which is this paper again?
In VLDB 2014, the name of the system is called Fushi.
OK, I'm not familiar. Sure, we can talk about this more. So first of all, you said about, in general, in these systems, you know, through the heartbeat mechanism, it's not that easy to achieve low latency for the allocation through the central scheduler. Sure, there are tricks you can play, also local queues, etc. But eventually, you know, allocation latency will become a problem, no matter. So even if, you know, just the algorithm that you are using in the central RM probably is not as efficient as the one, you know, just directly queuing something to the local queues, right?
Sure, but there's a lot of nice things with a centralized scheduler.
Totally.
You want to enforce the quota, enforce the priority, do preemptions efficiently.
So actually, if we didn't believe that the central scheduler was important, we would not have gone for a hybrid approach, right? So actually, what we're doing is for the tasks that are not as important or that, you know, have characteristics like very, very small with not really locality constraints, etc., that you can use the distributed scheduling. And also the other thing that the distributed scheduling, so already through the distributed scheduling, you get also a notion of priority, right? So you can really use whatever idle resources you have, you can always have a lower priority queueable task to be run and, you know, like fill in the differences. I agree with you that there are, I mean, I don't believe that we have reached the limits of the central scheduler. So still there can be done stuff in the central schedulers, but one way or another, allocation will be higher and, you know, you will reach the limits of the central scheduler sooner or later.
So, okay, thank you.
Hi. I want to follow up on his question, basically ask you how big are these? So in sort of last slide, you mentioned that the Mercury sort of fits in at the very lowest level. So how many nodes are we talking about, and what's the sort of number of tasks, how many tasks need to be scheduled in a second, and what is the actual scheduling time that you see in your centralized that even forced you to sort of consider? Because the way I see this work is sort of like you're kind of trying to offload some scheduling requests from the centralized RM away by using the distributed RM mechanism. So can you give some numbers on why?
So first of all, we don't do, sure, it offloads the central RM, but we don't do it for scalability. So we have the Yarn Federation, which targets really scalability. So let's say, assuming that, that said, we target up to, let's say, 4,000 nodes for a single cell of Mercury, which is actually what are the limits that the Yarn RM is giving us. So assuming that, you know, one way or another, somebody may ask all the requests to be centralized. So again, you reach the limit of the 4,000 nodes that Yarn gives you. And that was the one question you had, and then about how long it takes. So typically, when you have a 4,000 node cluster, you have your heartbeat to be set at 3 seconds. So given that you have this 3 second heartbeat, it depends how, you know, it can get from 1 second to 3 seconds the latency of allocation, right? Because you may have to wait. If you ask for something just when the heartbeat, just right after the heartbeat was sent, you will have to wait 3 seconds for the next heartbeat to ask, you know, to put your request on the central RM. So it depends, but it's in the order of a couple of seconds, I would say, from the moment you ask your request until you get the resources.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.